morning we celebrate the worship of the Word and worship and praise of God, we also remember our country's patriots, those who have served in the past, those who are serving now, the veterans of all our wars, those who have fallen in combat, those of the future. And why I designed the service and to do the two things that are sometimes the most difficult to do, that is keep the integrity of the worship to the Word, and also to the time that we are celebrating in our society, in our culture as well. It becomes sometimes a problem on Memorial Day, the 4th of July, Labor Day, Veterans Day, Mother's Day, Father's Day. You want to stay to the Word. Worship is where the Word is preached and where sacraments are celebrated. And so we do both of those things in this sanctuary. And I want to begin today with a Memorial Day prayer. Let us pray. Gracious Sovereign God, Lord of all nations, on this Memorial Day we pause to reflect upon our blessings as a nation and the high cost of those blessings for many. Thank you for the freedom we enjoy in this country, for opportunities to flourish, and for the security of our land. Thank you for those who have served in the armed services of our country, risking their lives for our liberty. Thank you for those who have given their lives in service to our country, sacrificing in such a costly way for the sake of others, including me. Thank you for a day set apart, not just for celebration, but also for solemn remembrance as we consider the sacrifices of so many in our military. O Lord, may we be more aware of just how blessed we are as a nation. May we be more grateful for our blessings, more faithful in our use of our resources, more eager to share with others. We pray today for the families and friends of those who have given their lives in service to our nation. May they be comforted in their sadness. May they be reassured that the sacrifice of the loved ones contributes to a worthy cause. May they be proud of those they have lost, entrusting their ultimate fate to your gracious hands. Even as we remember those who have given their lives in the past, we also think of those whose lives are on the line today. We think especially of the women and the men who are serving in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Syria, Yemen, and so many other places of conflict and violence. Protect them, Lord God. Encourage them. Bring them home safely, we pray. Give wisdom to the leaders of our armed services that they might know how best to deploy the troops in the cause of freedom. May their efforts be successful, so that true peace and justice may be established in your world. Guide those who lead our nation in international affairs. Help them to pursue diplomatic paths that prevent needless conflict. May they have your wisdom about when and how to use the military might you have entrusted to us. God of peace, stir in the hearts of the leaders of all nations and in all who would use violence to further their cause. Change their hearts and minds and give them a passion for peace. Bring an end to the pain, suffering, injustice, and violence in the world. Peace will not come until your kingdom is here in fullness. May your kingdom come, Lord, and your will be done as it is on earth, as it is in heaven. And all praise to you, God of grace, God of mercy, God of justice, God of peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. We are going to go right to our scripture lesson for today. And I have chosen the scripture from the 12th chapter of Luke, verses 13 through 21. As I was saying, every time we have these kinds of celebrations, it gives the pastor a little bit of a dilemma. And I was going through all the scriptures, the lectionary passage didn't seem to fit well. But then I ran across this, and many times pastors will use this scripture for a stewardship sermon. But I looked at it, and I came at it from a different direction. And I'm looking at this particular passage of scripture, and I entitled it, A Patriot's Heart. And I'll explain that as we go along. So I'm going to read the scripture now. It's from Luke 12. Someone in the crowd said to him, Jesus, Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me. But Jesus said to him, Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you? And he said to them, Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he thought to himself, What should I do, for I have no place to store my crops? Then he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain and all my goods. And I will say to my soul, Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich towards God. May the Lord have a blessing. Lord, we pray that you open our hearts and our minds. Not only would we be hearers of your word, but that we would be doers of your word. The heart of a patriot is an example of someone who has the heart of God, has the heart of the character of Jesus Christ, I believe. Because I can't see people making these kinds of sacrifices if they didn't have that kind of a heart. And we don't always get that heart right away, do we? It is a process that we go through. Sometimes we don't even know that we have that heart. For many years, I didn't know I had that heart. It was in my subconscious, because it was placed in there through many years and many things and many occurrences that took place in my life. And so as I looked at the scripture, I looked at a few verses there that really popped. And that was the 15th, the 17th, and the 19th verse out of that scripture. And I said, there is the heart of Jesus Christ, and there we can see that example within our patriots. And what we as a church, as a Christian church, whether we are military, whether we are not military, we are a member of this society, we are a part of this country, and we support, if we're not in the military, we support the military. We celebrate the fact that we have a strong military to protect us. So I'm going to go back and read that 15th verse again. Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he said to them, Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Take care, guard your heart from all kinds of greed. Now, this man who came to Jesus, this is not something that was out of the ordinary. You see, in this particular time, the rabbis were really kind of like the lawyers of our day, because the faith of the Jewish people was also the law of their land. God is king. The Ten Commandments and the interpretation of the Ten Commandments are our laws. And we have scribes and Pharisees who go over these laws and over these laws. We have rabbis that teach these laws. And when we have a dispute, we go to the rabbi. And so there was nothing unusual about what was happening here. But what was unusual is either Jesus had known this man, or Jesus had heard them discussing everything that was going on, but Jesus knew that this man's problem was not the inheritance. This man's problem wasn't the property. This man's problem wasn't the fact that he didn't have enough. This man's problem was his heart. And Jesus said to him, guard your heart from greed. Now, it's not just things we grow crops. It's not just money that we gain. It's not just houses we build or cars that we drive or all the other things. It's love that we share. It's time that we give to someone. It's all of those things together. Whatever our resources and blessings are, Jesus is saying, there's a bigger picture here. There is something beside you here. Wow. That took me back to the patriot's heart. Because I realized who in their right mind for $70 a month and room and board would join the Marine Corps. I did. $70 a month. All I could eat and all the orders I could take. And for a vacation, they sent me to Vietnam. Beautiful beach in South China Sea. And a jungle being. What more could a little boy from Pennsylvania ask for? And I realized that somewhere in my mind, there was a bigger picture. I didn't join the Marine Corps for the right reasons, but subconsciously I may have, but consciously, the recruiter told me I would never have to buy another beer for myself when I went into a tavern if I were a Marine. And I believed him. And then I saw Marines in dress blues. Wow! Women are going to love that. So I had two things going for me. But in my subconscious, something else was going for me. There was a war in Vietnam. There was going to be training. People were being killed. There has to be a bigger picture. And I thought about this, and I realized that when I went back to where I was, when I was raised, my parents were all consumed about sending me to church, to Sunday school, even if they didn't go to church in Sunday school. Though they did at times, and I would be with them for the church service, but Sunday school was before. Or if I were by myself, I was either doing one or two things. I was walking around the block until Sunday school was over so I could go home and pretend I went. Or I actually went. So about half the time I did go. And even though it, you know, it wasn't something I wanted to do, I got tired of walking around the block. But there must have been lessons there, there must have been something there, and the pictures that I colored, that the words and the teacher said, there must have been something there that embedded into my subconscious that said to me, there is something bigger out here than you, Terry. There's something that has a bigger responsibility that is worth you investing yourself in other things than yourself, even though I really didn't want to do that. And then Bible school. I remember I was 10 years old, and I was sitting in Sunday school, and little Debbie, the red-headed girl, said she was going to Bible school. Woo! I'm going to Bible school, too, because I'm going to sit beside the little red-headed girl. And so even though I wasn't motivated by the right thing, I was still there, and I still heard the lessons. Same thing happened in seminary. I got to seminary kicking and screaming and said, I don't want to be here. I already know everything I need to know. I read the Bible. I can preach. I don't need these people. But there was a girl there. Her name was Shirley. And I did, I want to sit beside her. So I went back. But somewhere in seminary, somewhere in Bible school, somewhere in Sunday school, somewhere in church, even though I cannot tell you the scripture that the pastor ever read to me, those principles somehow got in there. And I joined something that was so much bigger than myself. Now, though the scripture goes on, and if I can find it again, it will be miraculous. Oh, there it is. And he thought to himself, what should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there will store all my grain and all of my goods. So he said, my response to this is, I got to build walls around everything that I have. I've got to place walls. They'll keep people from getting anything there that I have. And I put these big barns up because then people will know just how important I am, how much I have amassed. God must love this man because look how much he has. But then what does that say about people who don't have anything? They have nothing. Does that mean God doesn't like them? Does it mean they're displeasing God? Does the Bible not say that the rain and the sun shines and falls on the same in all people, whether good or bad? On male and female, Jew and Gentile, it falls on everyone. So that doesn't work, but that's what he said in his mind. I'll just put all these big things up, and that'll save all those stuff, and I won't have to worry about anybody getting anything I have. But I have a feeling that that was never going to be enough. Because in my experience, it is never enough. Even with myself, I always want a little more. Or I want something for my kids that I didn't have. And that's important. I invest that in them. And people do that all the time. We invest in our kids' education. We invest in everything that they can get the SATs and they go to the right colleges and do the right things. But what about the hearts? And when it comes to possessions, how much is enough? $1 more than we have. Which really means it doesn't matter how much it is, so long as it's more than I have right now. And that seems to be what this man was saying. And Jesus was saying, and I don't have to read that next verse, I already know what he said to him. What is wrong with you? That's paraphrased, that's not exactly the word. But what is wrong with you, you fool? Tomorrow, you will not be here. Wow. How differently would we live if tomorrow we knew that we wouldn't be here? Except, a patriot's heart is not worried about what they have. They're not worried about what clothes they have. They're not worried about a car they drive, because most of them don't have a car. They're marching around everywhere they go. We got the same olive drab clothes on. We got the same haircut, just like I have right now. I'll never forget when they did that to me in boot camp. Wow! Really? Is that necessary? Yeah, I guess it was. But my point is, we ate the same food. We shared the same barracks. We shared the same spaces. We shared the same camaraderie. And when we marched along with someone dropped, someone picked them up. And we carry them along with us. That's what we do. So it's not a matter of that. A patriot's heart is like, what? The heart of Jesus Christ. Jesus would be one of those people. No man, no woman left behind. No one would have to be worrying about what they were going to eat. No one would have to worry about where they were going to sleep. No one were going to have to worry about whether they had medical coverage or they didn't have medical coverage. No one was going to have to worry that they were going to have to do all these things by themselves. No one was going to be there left alone, and nobody there was going to be left behind. And that doesn't seem to be the way of the world so much. But it is for those who have a heart of Jesus Christ and a heart of a patriot. And I include everyone in that patriot. Everyone in here is a patriot. Everybody here that looks at the flag, everybody here that supports the people who are there, everybody here that works and pays taxes, everybody here is a patriot. And we need to celebrate that, the blessings that we have. Tony Campolo, a pastor, a writer, and a professor at Eastern College in Pennsylvania, he told a story of a man who had just bought this most expensive BMW that he could find. All the bells and whistles. And he didn't care. He wanted the biggest motor, the biggest everything with it. And Tony says, it was a friend of his, and he said that we were discussing something, you don't know what it is, and someone said, they looked at his car, said, I wonder what car Jesus would drive if he were here today. And something sparked in that man's head. He goes, I wonder what he would drive. And he started thinking about that. And it bugged him so much. He sold his BMW. He got an old hat to drive around, and he sponsored 30 children at Compassion International to feed the hungry children. And he said he never felt like that before in his entire life. And he began to alter the rest of his life as well. And the things of his business, the things that he had accumulated, he said, this is the things that we are going to share with others. All of a sudden, some spark. And I have to believe that this man might not consciously know why he's doing all this and why he sees the bigger picture and why he has sat in church and he can't tell you what the sermon was, but something spoke to his heart. In the Word of God is a power. It's called the Spirit. The soul of our soul is the Spirit of God. And the thing that I think we really do have to pay particular attention to, if my parents hadn't stood by while I circled the block where I went to Sunday school, or hadn't made sure I went to Bible school, or hadn't made sure I went to church, would I have that bigger picture? But if nobody's doing that anymore, what does the next generation do? Where do people get that they're going to lay down their lives for somebody? If you noticed out here in the, where we had a little lunch or our refreshments, there's a crucifix. And next to the crucifix is a sign that says, just do the next right thing. And there's Jesus on a cross. Just do the next right thing. And whether we're a Christian just sitting in a pew, or if we're a soldier, or if we're a Marine, if we're a Coast Guard, if we're a National Guard, whatever we may be, an airman, whatever we may be, and we're in the field of battle, if it calls us to lay down our life for the next, that is the next right thing to do, then that's what we do. And all of us here want to do the same. May God bless us with a patriot's heart and the heart of our Lord Christ. And all I've got to add to that is, amen. It's 11 o'clock. We're singing the last hymn, 697. You know what? The plates are on there. So remember you're leaving.
I'll just pass the plate while we sit down.
There you go. There you go. That's what we're gonna do.
And I thought we were on time.
Yeah.
Would you like us to take them?
Let us stand and sing. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.